let's move on to the next session. The next talk on mycobacterial infections in organ transplant recipients. May I invite the speaker, Dr. Santosh Varghese. I now invite the chairpersons for this talk, Dr. Sajit Narayan, Dr. Firoz Aziz, and Dr. Ravi Angral.
Thank you first of all for the organizers for this giving me the opportunity to present this important topic, mycobacterial infections in organ transplant recipients. Since it's a big topic and time is brief, I will be just touching on very, very basic things and going a little on the faster side. And thanks again to the Kochi group for the wonderful ISOT meeting that we've had. Thank you very much. So as to begin with, as we know that both tubercular and non-tubercular mycobacterial infections are important in transplantation, I'd like to deal with them one by one, first looking at tuberculosis. Now, before we look at tuberculosis, as we just heard, infections are a problem, and they are a problem more than ischemic heart disease and rejections and graft dysfunction, which actually the rest of the world talk about. Infections has got high risk of mortality in our population compared to the West, and is an independent risk factor for mortality. This graph from my mentor and teacher shows that if patient had any infection, either CMV, tuberculosis, fungus, nocardia, PCP, HPV, HCV versus no infection, there is a definite impact on the mortality of the patient. So coming to tuberculosis per se, as we know, it's very common, highly prevalent and endemic in our community, and solid organ recipients are more vulnerable. And infections like CMV, which we just heard about, have effect on host immunity and can activate occult tuberculosis, causing significant morbidity and mortality, leading to economic burden, pill burden, primary and secondary resistance of the organism. The incidence and prevalence of TB is one of the highest in the world, and we are in the process of bringing out guidelines for infection treatment of all infections in South Asia, of which TB is an important one, and God willing, this will be published in the Indian Journal of Organ Transplantation very soon. Of the 1.8 million new cases, about 20% of the global incidence is supposed to be in India, and it's as high as 12.3% in renal allograft recipients in South Asia, India being most important. The actual burden may be actually higher than what we are reporting because of under-reporting and poor records and follow-ups, but we don't know that for sure. Most of TB occurs in the first month, with the global median time of onset being 9 months. The Indian data shows that the median onset of TB actually has shifted with the advent of CNI inhibitors. That's been so shown by the landmark calendar paper by Dr. John. We're working on the new calendar paper. And that shows that actually there's a shift in the timeline of mycobacterial infections. The highest risk of all organ transplants is in the lung transplant, not in other organs. And most cases are reactivation. There have, of course, been donor-derived or de novo has also been described. The de novo, we don't know. Maybe there are reactivations too because of past infection, but at least classified as de novo. And the higher risk is post-transplant compared to pre-transplant PS. Risk factors are varied, of which immunosuppression is the most important. Apart from that, malnutrition, renal dysfunction, diabetes, smoking, household contact. This is different from just a known contact. Past untreated tuberculosis being very important. Duration of dialysis, other viral infections, chronic liver disease. There's also some HLA predation which has been reported. Coexisting infections confer a higher risk, as we just heard also. Highest, as we said, is lung transplantation. Of the immunosuppression, the greatest risk is with lytic induction or ATG given for anti-rejection treatment. Of the CNIs, tacrolimus has got a lower risk compared to cyclosporin, and MPA a higher risk compared to azathioprine. And when we substitute azathioprine with mycophenolate, there's been reports of it having exacerbated or caused reactivation of TB. And the old Rubin paper shows that prednisolone dose of more than 20 milligrams a day is significantly has a significant impact. The natural history, we know the lung is the most common site from aerosol infection, and of the four possible outcomes of clearance, chronic latent infection, rapid progressive disease or reactivation. Chronic or latent infection or reactivation are the most important as far as the organ transplant recipients are concerned. The immune system attempts to kill the organism. Most of the time, we know granuloma and gonad complex formation is there. And then after that, there is either if there's ineffective fulminated immunity, there's destruction of the lung or erosion and dissemination or reactivation and can occur, and donor transmission can occur even 3 years after the surgery. The classic triad of fever, weight loss, and night sweats are not the clinical features that we see in tuberculosis, and the presentation is often insidious and atypical, with disseminated fever being there, disseminated TB causing fever, with only 2/3 of the focal illnesses having fever, and the 1/5 of the disease may be disseminated. About 1/2 the disease is in the lung or the pleura, and 15% present as PUO. The lymph node involvement is less than 5%. Now, other rarer things have been reported. We have reported some of these: pyomyositis, tenosynovitis, skin ulcers. Intersusception was reported by one of my colleagues. Granulomatous interstitial nephritis also was reported by one of my colleagues. This is the data from our institution showing that tuberculosis is in the lung, or pleura is little less than 1/2, and little less than 20% is disseminated. About 15% is PUO. About 1/2 to 2/3 occur in the first post-transplant year, with the median presentation in the latter half. And the risk of death, as we said earlier, of infection and death is because of T-cell depleting antibodies or rejection or disseminated tuberculosis. Now, there's one paper which shows that lytic induction with rapid ATG was actually had decreased risk of mortality compared to bevacizumab, but there's only been one center report. And renal allograft loss is 15% despite treatment. One study of more than 2,000 cases showed that. So as we know, high index of suspicion is needed. Therefore, we seek to suspect it in all our patients in which the fever does not settle, or we don't know what the cause of the fever is. Even though we use radiology, we need microbiological diagnosis, and history of travel, infected family members, usually not contributory, but past history of treated, untreated, or partially treated TB is useful. Cough and shortness of breath, as we know, is non-specific and in many infections or other immunological or non-immunological causes. The acid-fast, pasteurized stain culture, nucleic acid testing, the nucleic acid testing being the more recent test in our armamentarium, has been useful. And the standard algorithms are used like the general population. The culture from the appropriate specimen, the fluid or sputum being used, including CSF or abscess fluid, acetic fluid. But we must try and do biopsy and get the tissue cultures to look for the diagnosis. The pleural biopsy, transbronchial lung biopsy also needs to be done. And because of this, sometimes we have a delay in the diagnosis if the invasive procedures are required, the patient is ill. So as I said, tissue histology is important to look for in addition to the cultures. The gene expert TB-PCR has been found to be highly specific and sensitive, and has been found also in non-respiratory samples. Initially, WHO said it's only for respiratory samples, but now they say it's also for tissue specimens and CSF as well. And there's also additional support multi-drug resistant tuberculosis presence. The caveat is it may be falsely positive even after successful treatment, and it cannot replace the conventional drug susceptibility, even though we know it's rifampicin resistant. So what do we do is to screen all prospective TB post-transplant recipients with chest X-ray for lesions. And some people advocate CT scan, but that's not universal. There's one study which showed that in liver transplant patients, the CT scans which showed the prior TB scars predicting post-transplant TB when the X-ray was normal, but that's not been replicated. So radiological imaging may be the only clue, and therefore we need to look for them. As we know, the cavitary lesions are rare. Upper lobe prolection is not a distinct feature. Lesions are mostly bilateral. Fibrotic lesions are less pronounced in mTOR inhibitor-based immunosuppression. Gastric juice aspiration for microbacterial culture and AFB are not often done tests, but has been found to be useful, less risk to healthcare personnel, and you can do gene expert TB-PCR on the gastric juice aspirate as well. In the cultures up and smear with improved techniques and the fluorescent microscopy, we make the tests become more sensitive, as well as the inkjet culture with the growth occurring as early as 2 weeks. Using of IGRAs and tuberculin skin testing is not recommended for diagnosing active infection. So the most challenging situation is the reliance on clinical suspicion, because every PUO we need to consider, can it be TB, and look for pulmonary and extrapulmonary situation diagnosis of TB. Now coming to treatment, the treatment is multi-drug for appropriate duration. Two difficulties are toxicities and interactions, as we know. Multi-drug resistant TB is fortunately less encountered. The treatment duration is roughly the same as general population, with 4 drugs for 2 months and 2 to 3 drugs for 6 months if you are using rifampicin. Now the recommendation is that wherever possible, complete the treatment in the pre-transplant period. But sometimes you may diagnose a TB in the pre-transplant period and the patient may go for transplantation. Therefore, the recommendation would be complete the intensive phase prior to transplantation. So at least 2 months of INH and rifampicin before transplantation. And post-transplant use of rifampicin is challenging, as it can lower the levels of CNI and mTOR inhibitors, increase the dosage requirement of drugs, frequent monitoring cause risk of rejections, graft loss, and in one study, up high mortality. Therefore, there are options is use the fluoroquinolone like levofloxacin or ofloxacin in place of rifampicin. But then you use a prolonged course, 12. Some reports, including from Pakistan, of using 18 months of ATT. Rifabutin in place of rifampicin has been used because it got less enzyme induction, and it's very easy to remember. The dosage is the same as rifampicin. Patients who have completed the course do not require chronic prophylaxis. This is the list of doses. I'm sorry, the dose is a little lower than rifampicin. It's half of rifampicin. Sorry about that. The dose are standard doses with some of them requiring renal function dose adjustment. So when we come across community acquired or hospital acquired resistant tuberculosis, like the multi-drug resistant tuberculosis, INH and rifampicin resistance TB, or the extremely drug resistant, a new terminology called XDR, is resistant to INH, rifampicin, fluoroquinolones, and one of the injectables. It's important for that we treat them. But before that, diagnosis must not a clinical one. Lack of a response is not enough. We need to have a mycobacterial culture and sensitivity. And it's better to consult our ID colleagues before we start treatment. And the recommendation is not to add a single drug, because that will require inadequate underdosing. And of course, as always, enforce adherence to complete duration. The other drugs that we can use are these unusual drugs like cycloserine, ethionamide, use of aminoglycosides, para-aminosalicylic acid, and levofloxacin, moxifloxacin, which we have used, as well as less commonly used drugs which we can use in these patients. So patients require close monitoring for toxicities, especially drug toxicity, which INH, rifampicin, and pyrazinamide. And if hepatotoxicity occurs, all are stopped, substitute with non-hepatotoxic drugs, begin with INH to small doses and reintroduce them with slow escalation. And the INH hepatotoxicity may be quite high. In liver transplant series, about 40% had, more than 40% at INH-induced liver toxicity, requiring stoppage of the drug. The other common side effect is peripheral neuropathy, which we use pyridoxine for, like ethambutol, dependent causing dose-dependent optic neuropathy. The other small bit of information for those who are interested is pyrazinamide decreases cyclosporine exposure, which does not happen with tacrolimus. So in summary, for looking by the TB part of the presentation, common, we need to screen pre-transplant, treat pre-transplant, at least induction phase, and rifampicin may be continued, but with difficulty, or substitute the fluoroquinolone or rifabutin. With importance to look for drug interaction, drug toxicity, and drug resistance to treat after ID consultation. Switching gears to non-tubercular mycobacterial infections very briefly, these are relatively rare compared to other opportunistic infections in the post-transplant patients, but the problem is it's difficult to suspect and diagnose in solid organ transplant recipients. And these are formerly found in soil and water. The important causes of pulmonary infection is most common source. Most common disease manifestation is pulmonary infection. There are of the 180, more than 180 species, only 25 are important. That's good for us, that relatively less we need to know. But they have got major implications in morbidity and mortality, especially in morbidity. But with improved diagnostic modalities, diagnosis has improved, and therefore the increased incidence of reporting, perhaps than true incidence. And the good thing is they don't spread from person to person, unlike tuberculosis. The classification is what we learned in microbiology of the different types. The incidence depends on the organ transplantation, with the kidney being relatively low, less than 0.5%, but up to 2.3% in lung transplant. The even large centers which have its report this, there's only a small number of cases reports. Of these, again, some of most of them are in lung and heart transplant patients, and some of them have got both Mycobacterium avium complex as well as abscessus complex. So it's important to remember that there may be two atypical mycobacteria in the same individual. Usually a resistant organism abscessus and has a varied clinical outcome. But the mortality is not been different comparing the two types of non-tubercular mycobacteria. The people who are susceptible are people who got pre-existing lung diseases, as well as those with various immunological and non-immunological disorders. The risk is increased because of immunosuppression or with those who got structural lung disease. There's no consensus on treatment with those who have got prior non-tubercular mycobacterial colonization. Now, use the word colonization because some people we're not able to differentiate between colonization and infection in some conditions. But however, abscesses may be important because in some patients it's considered a contraindication for lung transplant. And other problems are in these patients, bronchial lavage is difficult in lung patients because they are maybe already having respiratory distress and you may be just dependent on the sputum culture and smears, and the cultures take a long time for growth. So eradication is ideal, but there are no guidelines pre-transplant that you must eradicate. The waiting for the BAL reports is also difficult. Therefore, some people say start multi-drug regimen treatment for these patients. And the other important thing is to have post-transplant strict infection control practices, especially disinfection of bronchoscopes, etc. If those who've got prior infections and who lung transplant, they suggest bilateral lung transplant rather than unilateral. The clinical manifestations may be pleuropulmonary, most common, or skin and soft tissue, osteoarticular lymphadenitis, or disseminated. Irrespective of the site of infection, the important thing, unlike tuberculosis, is uncommon constitutional symptoms. Diagnosis, as I said, is delayed, and therefore high index of suspicion is required. There are some guidelines of the American Thoracic Society and the National Infectious Diseases Society of America guidelines. These are developed for competent patients, but are used for solid organ transplant as well. Diagnosis requires clinical, both pulmonary and exclusion of other diagnosis, and microbiologic diagnosis, positive cultures, or on biopsy. The smear of may be enough, but the specimen must be incubated to grow and confirm the type of organism. The other newer diagnostics tests are available, but some of them got poor sensitivity, and Bacterium abscesses subspecies level identification is required because susceptibility is different. Radiological studies are important because they give you a clue as to the disease, and patients are given care and counseling about the possible source of infection. The treatment depends on the species or subspecies, depending on whether they are avium and the various and the duration is accordingly depending on Mycobacterium avium is given clarithromycin plus ethambutol plus rifabutin plus amikacin for at least 12 months. And if those who are refractory, you may need to add moxifloxacin or surgical revision. The abscessus complex is a very difficult one to treat with surgical debridement, moxifloxacin, clarithromycin, azithromycin, amikacin. I think I will not read all the different groups of organisms and the treatments because that's just an exhaustive list. The important thing is that multiple factors are known to affect the treatment course, because depending on the organism, susceptibility and ability of the patient to tolerate the drugs, no controlled studies, no specific guidelines for duration. And the recommendations are based on the available in the non-transplant population, which we have adopted. The important thing is multi-drug regime for months to years. And we need to rule out a disseminated disease. Consider removal of foreign body or surgical resection for patients who've got focal disease or those who are failing medical therapy. Okay, so then to conclude, fortunately, non-tubercular mycobacteria are rarer, but the morbidity and in some cases mortality is higher. They're difficult to suspect and diagnose these patients in solid organ transplant, especially lung transplants. I personally don't have any experience in lung transplant, therefore it's all what we have read. But however, like in all infections, the high index of suspicion is what the clinician will need. Prolonged cultures are required, and the treatment is varied depending on the species and subspecies. Thank you very much for your patient listening, and also would like to invite everyone for the ISN Frontiers meeting. Keep the dates earmarked, September 25 to 25, 2022, in New Delhi next year. Thank you very much for your patient listening.
Thank you, Dr. Santosh. Thank you for taking us through the issues related to tuberculosis and non-tuberculous mycobacteria. Of course, in the Indian subcontinent, it is very difficult to diagnose tuberculosis, especially in the post-transplant scenario, because the patient is immunosuppressed and the symptoms may not be that very significant. So you rightly pointed out the importance of a high index of suspicion and the various treatment modalities in the two forms of mycobacterial and non-mycobacterial infections. Due to short of time, we are forced to proceed further. So, thank you very much, Santosh, for that enlightening talk.
Congratulate you once again on the organization of the conference. Fantastic job.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. Thank you.
Thank you, Speaker and Chairpersons.